Welcome back, everybody. I'm Sandy Rosenthal, host of Beat the Big Guys, and I'm so excited about the guest that I have with me today. Her name is Karen Savage. She is a mother of four and an investigative journalist who has reported on climate change, environmental justice, policing, and other social justice issues. Karen is an alum of the Craig Newmont Graduate School of Journalism, where she won the Sidney Hillman Award for social justice reporting. Karen spent most of 2018 covering resistance to construction of the Bayou Bridge pipeline, which runs from Texas through the Atchafalaya Basin here in Louisiana to oil export terminals near the St. James community. So welcome, Karen. It's so nice to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm so honored that you reached out. So I'm excited to be here.
So am I. And we have a lot to talk about. But I want to start with mentioning just a moment, a woman by the name of Frances Crow, who recently passed away at the age of 100. I met Ms. Frances Crow in 2009 when she received the Joe A. Calloway Award for courage in civic work. And when I tell you she's tiny, I mean, she is the littlest person I've ever met. But she was a peace activist. And one of her favorite pet lines was, if you ask her, how often have you been arrested in your work being an activist? Her answer was, with a smile, not enough. Mm. And she said that to my face. And I thought to myself, I am not worthy of being an activist. I've never been arrested. So that day I had a new role model. And that day I realized that that needed to become a part of my future. I need to be arrested one day. And I recently looked up this Frances Crow, just before this interview. And that's when I found out that she had passed away at the age of 100. And in the New York Times story about her, she was described as a tiny, sprightly woman with a thick mop of white hair, a pleasant smile, and a polite manner that belied her determination. And in the New York Times article, it mentioned that line that she hadn't been arrested enough, not enough. So she said, and I feel honored that I got to speak with her and hear that line myself. And I'm honored to be talking with you today because I understand that you too, Karen, was recently arrested.
Well, I can never compare to her. It sounds like she's done so many amazing things. But I was arrested while reporting on the Bayou Bridge Pipeline, resistance to the Bayou Bridge Pipeline in Louisiana. I am a reporter and, I had been arrested in the course of reporting before. But this was the first time that it was under the new law, which Louisiana had passed. And so to kind of give you some background, the resistance to the pipeline started in 2017, which was the year before I was arrested. There were public meetings. There was a groundswell of opposition. And eventually, as often happens in Louisiana, the pipeline company got its way and construction began. So I was very fortunate to have been at a place in my career, in my life, I could go down and just kind of be embedded in the area and cover the protest the entire time. And it was really—
Thank you. As a non-journalist and a non-photographer, thank you for your work.
Oh, well, you're very welcome. But it was, I mean, honestly, outside of the arrest, which was not fun, but it was, Louisiana is an amazing place. The natural beauty is stunning. People were friendly. And so, I was very fortunate to have been able to do that. But I went down there in 2018. And in the beginning, the early months of that year, it was mostly reporting on rallies or banners or little actions that folks had to kind of stop the construction. And it was around that time that the legislature had passed the law, and many people refer to it kind of informally as the felony protest law, which it's technically a trespassing law on critical infrastructure. And what it did was it expanded the definition of critical infrastructure to go beyond just refineries and facilities and things like that to include pipelines. And in Louisiana, there are hundreds. There's who knows how many miles of
pipeline. Everywhere.
I'm not sure Louisiana knows how many pipelines.
Actually, I can answer that question. 10,000 miles.
Yeah.
Of pipelines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, you know, basically you could fall out of bed and trespass on a pipeline easement. But they passed that. And, you know, Louisiana had, like other states, already had laws for trespassing. Trespassing was already had legal consequences. But this law in particularly was written by ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Commission. And they had a model law. And then LOGA.
So other states have this law as well.
Well, other states have been trying to pass the law. Mm-hmm. Not every state has been successful, but it was at one time, there were like 5 or 6 states that had similar laws. I don't know the exact number right now. I haven't looked that up lately. But in 2018, it was the Louisiana Mid-Continental Oil and Gas Association, so LMOGA, drafted it and proposed it into the legislature. And working closely with that organization, that's a fossil fuel company organization, working closely with that was Energy Transfer Partners, who was working to build the Bayou Bridge pipeline and didn't want the same type of resistance it had met in Standing Rock. So this law was particularly targeting folks who were wanting to exercise their First Amendment right to oppose the pipeline.
It's reprehensible. I'll be honest, I don't remember this law being in the legislature. It seems to me I would have been up in Baton Rouge fighting it. And I wonder if it got sneaked through while people weren't looking.
Yeah, it was advertised in some ways. And I know there was some pretty good resistance. I think the Bucket Brigade had resisted it, and folks with Lower Levee, the resistance camp, had voiced their opposition. But yeah, I believe it passed pretty easily, given the nature of Louisiana.
This is Louisiana. I'm sorry to say that's the sort of bill that would get a lot of support in comparison to the resistance.
Right. And so what it did is it added all these pipelines to critical infrastructure, and it changed the trespassing charge from a misdemeanor to a felony. So if you're arrested and you're convicted under this charge, you could be sentenced to 5 years in prison with or without hard labor and up to $1,000 in fines. So this all happened in the spring. I was reporting, and at the time there were characters around that were private security type folks. Now the company had already tried to get Tiger Swan, which was the mercenary force that had helped Energy Transfer Partners in North Dakota, which had been very brutal against the folks up there, the indigenous resistance and their allies. And Louisiana said, no, Tiger Swan was not allowed to operate in the state.
Are you talking about the Native Americans took a stand against the pipeline in Dakota? Is that what you're talking
North
about?
North Dakota, yes.
North Dakota?
Yeah, okay. And this is the same company, and it's actually a leg of that same project.
Gotcha. Very, very frightening, creepy people, I understand.
Right, right. But they weren't allowed to work. So I'm like, who are these folks? So one day I was out there, it was maybe April. I was just taking pictures of the easement, the pipeline of construction. Nobody was around. It was a Sunday. Nobody was working. I honestly didn't even need more pictures of the pipeline. I had like thousands of pictures of various forms of pipeline construction at that point. And I was about ready to go back to where I was staying. And an unmarked cruiser comes barreling down this little, tiny little country road with deep ditches on each side at me. I thought it was going to hit me. It stops in front of me. I couldn't go anywhere. Two guys jump out, they have their hands on their weapons. And they, you know, come at me, and I'm by myself. There's no one around.
Right.
So they came over to the car and they asked me nothing. They just asked for no ID. They didn't want my ID. They didn't want my registration. They just wanted to know what I was doing. Who was I working with? And now then my red flag started going up. I'm like, I am on this country road, and they're not asking me the questions that law enforcement normally ask. So I started asking them some questions. I'm like, which agency are you with? You know, who sent you? What are you doing? You know, blah, blah, blah. They gave me no information. They would not give me their names. They wouldn't give me their agency. They never took my license. They never took my registration. I know it was a police car or a law enforcement type car. They called somebody on radio and found out that I was driving a rental that I had picked up in Lafayette, which was true. I had gotten the car that morning, picked up a rental. So because I had different rentals each, you know, they expire, you have to trade them in.
Sounds like you should call the police to me.
Right. They had some kind of information. Yeah. So they finally said, well, look, you just got to leave. And this was like after 10 minutes. And like the whole point, I believe now in hindsight, was to scare me away.
Right.
It was really scary. I'm going to be honest. I'm in the middle of a like remote country road. There's nobody that saw that interaction. Luckily, I had a camera with a fairly good zoom lens. So as they were pulling, they had did like a little thing and turned around as they were leaving. I took a picture of their plate.
Good for you.
And so I had a picture of the plate and it took me a while, but I had a source who was able to run it and it came back to the Department of Corrections. The Louisiana Department of Corrections. I'm like, all right, this is really weird. You know, why is the Department of Corrections chasing me around? You know, like that's like after you are arrested and convicted.
And actively attempting to intimidate and frighten you.
Right. So my reporting eventually led me to do a public records request, which helped me figure out that the probation and parole officers in the Department of Corrections had been hired by the pipeline company to work security. And they were using the obviously Department of Corrections vehicle. They had on, and you know, I should have said this before, they had on these zip up suits that I could tell they had a badge and it was in the shape of Louisiana on the badge, but they like clearly didn't want me to see who they were. So anyway, that's how I figured that out. And I eventually did some reporting on that. I had talked to a representative from the Department of Corrections. And it took a while. So it was like, fast forward now, this is in August, talked to somebody and pretty much caught them in a lie. Because first they had said, well, they're not allowed to use their uniforms or any vehicles or anything like that. And then the documents they sent me did not match what they had said. Later, the backpedal was that the policy had been changed and altered. And, you know, there's all kinds of details there. But bottom line is, I was ready to publish the story. The very next day after I had that interview, I was arrested for the first time. So, you know, it was the next, the next day.
So they knew you were about to go public with a story. And
I believe that's part of it.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
You know,
well, they knew. We know that's a fact. And
right.
So I saw, so this was recent though, this is another incident. When was this incident where you were arrested?
That was in August of 2018.
Okay,
Just after the felony law had gone into effect.
Okay.
I was arrested while I was reporting on water protectors. The protesters in these types of resistances, they call themselves water protectors. Mm-hmm. And so I was reporting on them. They were in a remote place in the Atchafalaya Basin where they had been invited to be by the landowners. Mm-hmm. Because the landowners were opposed, some of the landowners were opposed to the pipeline project and hadn't given the company their permission to be there. So I had the landowner's permission. Water protectors had the landowner's permission, but the pipeline company did not have permission to be there. The first time I was arrested, I wasn't on an easement. An easement is the part of construction where they consider the critical infrastructure. When they do, you've probably seen when they build these pipelines, there's the center where the pipeline goes, but then there's like maybe, I don't know, 25 feet on each side for equipment and dirt and piles of stuff. And I wasn't on any of that. I was back farther. So I was arrested with some other water protectors at that time.
And that was about 3 years ago, a little more than 3 years ago.
Right. That was in August. Mm-hmm. Did some more reporting and around that time realized that the probation and parole officers that became public. There was another reporter who had also covered that. And it just, I think, got too much public information. So they were pulled off. St. Martin Parish Sheriff's deputies then took a prominent role. And they were also in my reporting and discovered through records requests, they were also being paid by the pipeline company. So, you know, the deputy might have a day off, say Tuesday is their day off, but they're out there at a work site then I knew by looking at their records of their work days, if, you know, the workday records say Tuesday, this guy didn't work, but I have a picture of him documented at the site. That's when I knew they were working for the pipeline company. And eventually we got the records and the confirmation and the list of the deputies that were doing the work. And this is why I want to say, I know your show is about empowering people to do stuff in their communities. Anybody can do a records request. So if you're listening and you are curious about why the sidewalk in front of your house is always in crumbling or anything at all, it doesn't have to be a huge thing, just anything, do a records request. Most places, I have to say, are very friendly. The public information people will help you. So that was, without that, it would have been,
I am going to step in and agree with my guest. It is very easy. I've done more than I can count, and much of the most important data that I've found over the years has been through the public records request. We've already devoted one episode just to the Freedom of Information Act and how important that is. But this is yet another example. And I'm glad that you reminded our listeners about that. It's easy, it's free, it's easy, and there's nothing to be afraid of. In my book, I call it, it's like asking your mother a question. It's as simple as that. And it's a right that we have as a citizen. But
right.
Enough about me. You go on. So did your story get published?
It did get published. I published the first story about the probation and parole officers working for the pipeline company in the appeal. And I can send you a link if you want to put it somewhere so folks can find it. And then I did a follow-up story later on that was published in an outlet called In These Times. And that was on the St. Martin Parish Sheriff's deputies who were also working for the pipeline company.
So did you get put in the paddy wagon and have to spend the night in a jail, in a cell?
I was very lucky. So I was arrested actually twice while reporting on this pipeline construction. The August arrest was in the basin. And so it was on a really remote place where you could not get to without a boat. So I was arrested with a couple other people, probably like a quarter mile or a half a mile in from the waterway on land. So they kind of marched us back to where the boat was and eventually got us in a boat and took us back to the dock and then put us in a car and took us to the St. Martin Parish jail. So,
and how long did you have to stay there?
I was only there about maybe 7 or 8 hours. The first time, and the second time I was there even less because the jail had like a flood problem. I don't know. I was there with Ann Whitehat, who was one of the indigenous leaders of the resistance. And they had us in this room and there was like water running all over. There was like a horrible problem. And then I was very lucky to have, you know, folks who were on the outside who kind of knew to look out for me and got me out.
One of the few people that would call a flood a lucky thing in Louisiana.
Right, right. And it was not lucky, I have to say, for the other folks who were in there. You know, the folks who are incarcerated in there for longer periods of time. I was arrested twice and eventually became part of a lawsuit because that law, the critical infrastructure law, it violates the First Amendment on a couple of different ways. So if you are a water protector or a protester, it violates your First Amendment right to voice your opposition. Free speech is right there. And if you are a reporter, it violates your First Amendment right to report on those things as part of the free press and to do so in a way that doesn't come with retribution. And what that law does is it opens the door so that I truly believe that both of my arrests were because of my reporting. The second arrest was at a boat ramp. I was miles from any pipeline easement. They made up some stuff that I had a warrant, which of course I didn't. There were many water protectors there at the time. And as I was, they eventually put me in the back of a police car. And as I was sitting there, I heard over the radio them talking about arresting large numbers of water protectors. So I don't know at this point what they had planned. Nothing ever happened that day other than my arrest and the arrest of Ann Whitehat, who is one of the leaders. But there was also another photographer who was there that day, who was an independent guy who was unexpectedly there. The law enforcement, the pipeline company, everyone knew to expect me because I had been there the entire time.
So when you were, and I hope I'm not jumping ahead, but they let you go after 7 or 8 hours. And why did they let you go?
Because I was bonded out.
You were bonded out. Okay.
Yeah.
So, and so I'm sorry, explain to, some of our listeners might not be familiar with that. So what's next after you're bonded out? You pay a fee and, so.
Yeah. To be bonded out, the person who's bailing you out basically finds a bail bondsman, who takes a percentage of whatever your bail would be. And then you're out. And as long as you report back to whatever court dates that you have, you're fine.
And then, and so what happened when the court date arrived? Did they drop, they dropped it?
What happened is in Louisiana for felonies, the DA, the district attorney, who's the one that presses charges, has 4 years to bring those charges. And so starting on in 2018, the time wouldn't have expired until 2022.
Wow.
And so basically what you're doing is you're just kind of sitting there knowing, like in my case, in the case of some of the other, the folks who were arrested for the protesting, that they faced either 5 years or 10 years, some of them, if they had two charges or like I did, behind bars, and these fines, but not knowing whether it's ever going to be pursued, which is a really weird legal limbo to be in. And also being out on the bail, knowing that, you know, they can revoke that. The police department can, the law enforcement can revoke your bail if you end up inadvertently having something else happen. So it was really, it was a very unsettling.
Yes.
Time to just have that kind of hanging over my head.
I'm having an image of, I think I learned this in school as a little girl. I think there was a play of someone sitting in a chair with a sword hanging over his head, hanging, and at any moment the sword could just drop. Okay. So that's how it feels listening to this. You, at any time, the bond, you said, could be, what did you say? Revoked? Is that what you said?
Well, if you do something, like say you get in a traffic altercation or something else happens where you have some other interaction with law enforcement, it can be revoked. Or revoked. The DA could decide, okay, today's Wednesday. I think I'll press those charges now.
Yeah.
And so then you end up being hauled into court.
The bail or the charge and hanging over your head for 4 years.
Right. I'm an older white woman with blonde hair. Who's literally named Karen, which is weird at this day and age. But the repercussions that I have being involved in the justice system or so-called justice system are far fewer than brown and black and different folks who don't have some of the, to be really honest, white privilege that I just have just because of the color of my skin. So it was unsettling, but many people, I think, had a more unsettling experience. So I just
want to be right about that. And you raise a very, very good point. So is it a good time to move on to the reason that I asked you to come on to my show, your more recent arrest? And this is the one that I read about. And I said, I want to have that lady on my show. Is it a good time to segue to that?
That is. And I think the more recent one that you read about was the... So I was arrested in August of 2018, and then again in September of 2018. And those are the most recent ones, but they were recently dropped. So like I said, the DA has 4 years to press charges. And so that 4 years hasn't yet expired. But I am part of a lawsuit that will hopefully succeed and show that the law itself, the critical infrastructure law, is unconstitutional.
And just to clarify, I apologize for jumping in. Your more recent arrest was when?
2018. They were the same for Bayou Bridge.
I thought there was an arrest just a few months ago.
Nope, nothing recently. So, now I did publish something about the charges being dropped.
Okay,
that maybe what you saw in this log, I did like an op-ed.
And that's what led me to believe that that arrest was recent.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that's 28, that's recent. That's pretty darn recent. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you for clarifying that.
Oh, you're welcome.
So anyway, why don't you go ahead and continue?
Yeah. But I think too, that being part of that lawsuit in May, a judge ruled that it could go ahead. The lawsuit is against various folks in the state, basically with the goal of striking down that law as being unconstitutional, because it interferes with the First Amendment rights of various people. And so in May, the judge had a rule that the three of us who are on the lawsuit, which is Ann Whitehat, mm-hmm. myself, and another individual who was also arrested, could remain on the lawsuit, and it could proceed. And it could proceed against the DA. So I think part of the reason our charges were officially, we were told that our charges would officially be not pursued, was in the context of that suit.
Okay.
Not to mention, just to be really honest, I had written permission to be on that land. The water protectors had written permission to be on that land. As a reporter, it is my job. I can report, but I can't trespass. You know, I still have to obey the laws. And I was I took very good care, because I've been in Louisiana enough to know that if the oil and gas industry can find a way to kind of like get you away from them, they will, so they can do what they want. So I made sure I had all my stuff in a row. So I had permission to be there. The company, the judge actually later ruled that Energy Transfer was the company, was the one trespassing, because good. They didn't have permission to be working at the time.
Good. But that's a success.
Right.
That you filed this lawsuit, and you, because of this lawsuit, the charges were dropped.
Right. Now, that wasn't necessarily the only goal of the lawsuit. It's a great mm-hmm. thing that happened. Mm-hmm. But the goal is to make sure that the court and the legal system, that law is taken off the books.
Right. So it's a small win for the three of you, and a huge win for us all.
Right. Right. And I think what folks often, you know, the law is technically the Critical Infrastructure Protection Act or something like that. Mm-hmm. But many, many times it's referred to by folks as the felony protest law or a felony protest law. And by doing that, it makes folks hear the words protest. And it might make people who are just not in their nature to protest things saying, that doesn't affect me. I'm not a protester. I'm not a protester either. I'm a journalist. It affected me. It could affect anybody who's a landowner who's out there doing something on their land. It could affect anybody who happens to be on a pipeline easement. And as we just talked about, there's hundreds of thousands of miles of pipeline in Louisiana. So, you know, it's a danger. That law is a hazard to everyone who could end up on one of those easements.
I understand. And thank you for your bravery, not only in doing your work, but also in filing this lawsuit. I mean, you took the bull by the horns. You and Ms. White and this third person took the bull by the horns. And that is admirable. That is phenomenal.
Well, I'm very lucky, I have to say, to have, like you said, great co-plaintiffs and also some great attorneys that are helping us out to do that. And I just think it's also important, you know, if folks that are listening see law enforcement working for companies, kind of to call that out, because it's also another thing that kind of motivated me to keep going, is that when you see a law enforcement officer in full uniform with a weapon, with a badge, driving a car that is clearly a public vehicle, it makes you think that this is someone who is working for the public, right? And should therefore be protecting both the private companies and the citizens. And in the case of this pipeline resistance, many of the law enforcement officers that we came across looked like that, but in fact were security for the pipeline company.
Thank you so much for bringing this to our attention. It just, in a word, it's wrong. I mean, I don't have to be an attorney to know that that's wrong. They were masquerading.
Right.
They were masquerading.
Right. And if corporations can buy our public services, where are we?
Oh, they have infinitely deep pockets. Fortunately, right. The big guys make big mistakes. And do real dumb things, which can be used to our advantage when we are working on beating the big guys. There's something that you mentioned that I wanted to go back and talk about just a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And it looks to me, I mean, I was listening carefully. It was a lot of information to take in, but it sounds to me like this law was intended to do much more than what it says it's going to do. Sounds to me like it's an intimidation tactic to intimidate people to even think about protesting a pipeline construction, to chill them out of even out of calling someone saying, you want to do something about this? It's just to stop us, you know, the people in our tracks. It looks like an intimidation trick to me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, I'm very fortunate in my career as a journalist. It's not gotten in my way. But, you know, if you are someone who wants to get a nursing license or a teaching license or certain other jobs where they look into your background and you've even been arrested under this law, it will come back. So it's definitely an intimidation tactic.
To chill public participation.
Right. Exactly.
And that may be, in my mind, I think that's the number one goal. Mm-hmm. I really don't think they ever intended to use it. And so far it hasn't worked very well for them.
Right.
And you know, in my mind, it's to chill public participation. And what the important thing is to recognize this, recognize mm-hmm. the intimidation tactic, and it's what it is. It is meant to intimidate, meant to frighten, meant to scare. Another example, I don't want to digress, but I discuss it a lot in my book, Words Whispered in Water. It is the threat of lawsuit. All the big guys have to do is threaten you with lawsuit and not actually follow through.
Right.
That'll do the job.
Right. Right.
That often will do the job. Unfortunately, for the big guys that I was working with, the federal government, I didn't back off. I said, mm-hmm. go ahead, sue me. And it was very embarrassing because they did back off. But I called their bluff.
Right. And okay. I think that's key, right? When they think that they're going to get you, you kind of turn around and get them.
Right. Right. You know? It was me and a bunch of high school kids that called their bluff. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if I can do it, anyone can do it. And so I hope y'all are listening. I hope it never come to that. But one thing for sure, you have nothing to fear, especially with me and Karen here to help you.
I can't wait to read your book, though. So that's my next step, is to go order that.
Karen, my publisher, will be so pleased.
Okay, good.
And you mentioned something else I would love to go back and talk about a little bit more. You mentioned that you caught them in a lie, right?
Right.
And that is a really key thing to do. If you're going after the big guys, if you can catch them in a lie and get a good old documentation of that, that's very powerful, because right. often the cover up is worse than the crime. We see it all the time. The cover up mm-hmm. is worse than the crime. Can you elaborate on that a little bit, on that lie that you caught them in and what you did with that?
Right. So basically, that was with the Department of Corrections mm-hmm. and their policy, which was, I was given, I believe in July of that year, said they couldn't use any kind of state owned gear or vehicles or whatever if they worked a side job for a company. And here they were using all of this gear and using the vehicles or whatever. And I talked to the individual from the Department of Corrections who said that policy had been changed. I said, oh, that's really interesting, because in July you sent me this. Oh, no, we've been meeting on this for months. We've got a revised document. We'll send it to you. So when I get the revised document, I'm like, oh, this is interesting. Let me see when it was revised. It was revised about an hour after I had the interview with the gentleman on the phone. So,
good work.
Yeah. And that's another, you know, if you're somebody who's digging around in records, look at the metadata of the documents that folks send you. Because if it's a Word doc or whatever it is, it'll tell you when it was revised and who revised it last.
Good point.
Always take a look at those things. And, you know, you never know what you might learn, because like you just said, they make big mistakes.
They make big mistakes.
Right. Yeah.
I think that could be a subject of a whole episode. I think it's arrogance. You know, they think they have so much money and so much power that they get arrogant and forgetful, and they do it all the time. It's not like if once in a while they make a mistake. They make a lot of mistakes. And
they're so used to getting their way. You know, I was also a whole different episode, maybe sometime. I have also been sued by a company over something that I wrote with someone else. And they basically wanted to intimidate us. They just wanted us to not say it. But they got so, they're so used to getting their way that when we said, no, we are not taking it down, they got enraged. And it was this male ego thing going on. And I'm like, okay. And then the more angry they got, the more mistakes they made. And so, you know, as I know you have found out, the more mistakes they made, the more attention comes to the mistakes that they're making, and they make even more. And it's just like a whole snowball effect.
They there's a word for that. Hubris shall bring them down.
Mm-hmm.
but enough of me talking. Back to you. Is there anything else that you would like to share with our listeners? We kind of run out of time, but is there anything that you can add to provide encouragement to our listeners today?
Just keep at it. And sometimes, so, you know, I've told you all kinds of things that happened over the course of 2018, from like January to the August and September. There were only maybe 4 or 5 days that were super important that I talked about, but part of it was just being there every day, right? I was at those actions or protests, taking pictures of the name badges of the deputies. And without having been there doing that sort of boring work all the time, I would have never been able to piece it together. And so no matter what you're doing, it could be the most important thing that you do towards that cause. You just don't know it because it hasn't played itself out. And I have heard a couple of your other podcasts and get different guests said, what really spoke to me is it takes time. And all of this stuff takes time. You know, my reporting took time. We don't know what will happen with that law. That will take time. So even though we want everything fixed, like right now, it's all of that stuff. And if you're doing something right now and you don't think it's even that important, it's probably very important.
Very well put. If it's really big and really important, it's not going to be fixed in a day.
Right.
It does take time. And because it takes time, it does take a tenacity and persistence. And we're not going to lie, it doesn't happen overnight. But if you just stick with it, and no matter what, it's always going to take a little longer than you thought it would.
Right.
But it's going to be
worth it.
Don't
let those guys scare you. Just keep doing. If you're working on something you know is right. In my case, I was documenting. I offered to go along with the police department. They didn't want me to. I offered to ride along with the pipeline construction company. They didn't want me to. So I was just there documenting. If you're doing something that needs to be done, that's the right thing to do. Don't let them intimidate you.
Right. And besides,
and if I can do it, anybody can do it.
I feel the same way. And me and Karen, we're here to help you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Well, thank you again, Karen Savage, for joining me. And I hope all of you enjoyed this episode. Make sure to subscribe, rate, and review this podcast on all of your favorite platforms. And remember, no matter who you are, you can beat the big guys.